get in there, and we're not just coaching for talent. So this is going to be physics of a circle. Disclaimer, I'm not a physicist. This is just some stuff that I've gotten from my own career and from my own coaching tools. So let's get started. Just really quick, a little bit about me. This is going to be drawn into the presentation later, so we'll just run through it. I was a pretty crappy JO gymnast. I qualified at JO Nationals twice as level 10. 2009, I was 64th on pommel horse. 2011, I was 46th. So definitely nothing super exciting that you would expect to see a lot of growth from. This is a video from 2009, just to kind of reference that circle. Not too big, pretty sloppy. I got like 3 half falls in this routine. But just kind of so you guys can see where this is at. OU on whim, and that very first year, you got a big jump up to 17th, and that's, we're talking NCAA championships. So this is 2.5 years after that video that we just watched. So already you can see it's a lot smoother, got rid of a lot of those form breaks. So there you go. That was my freshman year. The rest of my career went like this. So you can see high school pretty low, and then towards the end of my career, you got this exponential kind of growth. So the reason I bring this up is because I think when we think about pommel, we try to aim for that perfect circle, that perfect extension from day one. But this is more of the normal growth pattern for pommel horse. And then I'll come back to this later with a couple more notable athletes. But you can see it starts pretty slow, and then as we continue, we get that quick break. So, that's my spiel. We'll get into some of the basics of the physics that we're actually here to talk about. Pommel is already hard enough. Don't make it complicated. We're dealing with a circle. That's it. The same thing you learned in basic geometry. So, we know from that we've got 360 degrees. We also know that circles are symmetrical. So, when we're talking about how do we coach pommel, we can use these lines of symmetry. Anytime you see a fall here, or a form break here, or any kind of struggle, we can literally trace it across the other side of that circle, and that's gonna be the cause. So using that simple idea of geometry can help us in our coaching. This is one of our little guys, just to give an example. He's got your basic beginner circle, pretty good quarter, pretty good half, and as soon as he goes to the full, he slides right off the end. There you go, slides right off. And of course, he's leaning the wrong way. We're gonna tell him about how he should lean the other way, how we're trying to fix that. But if we look at this from a physics standpoint, we can see that circle on the bottom should be flat. We know he's falling off somewhere here, so we should see our problem right there. He jumps high. So that's easy enough to kind of track it back. Yeah, there you go. So that's kind of the way it works out. Pretty simple example, but if you're looking at flops, if you're looking at woos, or you're looking at travels, you can do the same thing. It doesn't matter what the skill is. Anywhere you're seeing the problem, we've got that symmetry, so we can draw it over to the other side. So that's the first part. Next, there's a couple pommel lectures floating around talking about this truncated cone. Put it simply, that circle on the top, the smaller one, is the path that your shoulders are following, and the one on the bottom is the one that your feet are following. So we know that we've got 2 paths of movement here, and then of course, those are connected through the middle. So if your shoulders are on the right side, your feet are on the left side, and they circle to kind of keep that balance going. But it's really not that simple. So I think the key go-to drills, especially when we're talking about shaping and we're talking about those large optional skills that we love to get to, we're thinking about the lean, we're thinking about how to balance, but there's so much more to that picture. So especially when you're programming, you've got to consider a little bit more than that. We're missing our biomechanics, and this is how our body creates these motions. So here is Alan Bauer from Gymnastics Bodies. They do really good work. He's doing a dip. Wish I could pause this.
Escape is good.
Got it. Perfect. Okay. What I wanted to show here, these lines that they drew on kind of represent some of the relationships that we're looking at. So of course we know we've got our upper and lower body as two separate pieces represented by this white line here. And then the one that coaches are most commonly known with is this lighter orange line there. That's our posterior chain. So when you're telling your kids to be tight, when you're trying to get them to make everything connect, we're talking about that yellow line there that kind of pieces their body together. But the big piece and the most important part when you're talking about developing, especially with kids, is all of these extra lines that they have drawn here. So of course we have our body, but we need to figure out how does his arm connect to his toes. That is key when we're talking about pommel. So we have that same orientation in our circle, upper and lower body. Those are connected. And then the key takeaway here, what I'm going to focus on for the majority of this presentation, is these next couple lines. Your support. So the only thing we're touching while we're doing this stuff is the pommel horse. So no matter what you're doing with your body, whether you want to hollow, whether you want to arch, whether you want a hip turn, whether you want to fix a skew, everything you're doing has to come from the pommel horse. So whether your kids are successful or whether they fail long term is dependent upon that little triangle in the middle. I'm going to call it your support. It's basically how you're connecting your body with the pommel. So that's what we're looking at. Things that can affect this. Obviously, strength is a factor. We know this. We do our L's, we do our planges. That's key. If you're talking about natural pommel guys, we're going to pick it up really quick. We're looking for those guys who have like a really long neck when they're doing their swings and their circles. You don't have to tell them to push tall, but just kind of naturally do it. That's your dead giveaway. That kid has a strong support. It's going to be easy for them. Flexibility, yes and no. If you have tight wrists, that's an issue. Personally, I think it's more of a consistency thing. If you're hitting pommel every day, even low numbers, you won't have as many wrist problems. Shoulders, I think, gets a big rap, but I want to touch on it just really fast. Especially for single pommel and skew, when we're talking about those things, we tend to think that bigger guys can't single pommel, and can't not do a skew on a pommel horse. But that's more of a technical thing as far as biomechanics. You guys can try this. If you roll your shoulders forward, your shoulder blades pull apart, and you've got all the space you want. It's not difficult. If you're trying to do a big extended circle and you pull your shoulders back, you're pinching your scaps together, and now all of your flexibility is gone. So as far as flexibility, we can see what we're talking about. As far as flexibility, you can be the widest guy in the world and still hop up on a single pommel and get it done. I think that comes from watching guys like Chao Kang have a big open circle, but if you can slow it down, you can zoom in on his back, you'll see he still has rounded shoulders. He's still opening his steps up so he can make that space. So what we're really looking for, in general, I think you just need an L and be consistent, you can make it work. All right, so how do we build this? Start small, stay simple. That is going to be repeated throughout this. Again, I think it's pretty normal to try to go big from day one. We know everybody does those positions on the side. Everyone does the front support, your support, side support. But when we're talking about long-term development, what you really want to focus on is how strong their support is and how well they connect with the members. So I'm going to give you guys two examples. Sorry, they're so tiny, but these are just two videos of some athletes with some circles that I kind of like. So we'll go through, if you can see that. He's sorry. He's pretty piked, pretty small. He has almost no space between his hands and his hips, but he looks very stable. This is a kid who's not going to fall off.
Yeah.
So that's what I would be looking for day one. It's a little cringy, the judges are going to hate you, but check this out. Who does everyone think that is? Elite athlete, competes now. Any guesses?
No.
That's Rhys McClenahan, 2009 European Palm Horse champion, known as one of the greatest extended circles on our quad. So this guy's circle is gorgeous now, but it didn't start there.
Wow.
He started, again, and I'm going to say this over and over and over again. I'm sorry if it gets annoying. But when you're talking about long-term extension and long-term success, you've got to start with the support. So that's what you're seeing there. This bottom video, same story, almost the same exact circle. Pretty small, pretty spiked, piked, not a lot of space, but a lot of control. Any guesses on that one? American. That's Steven Edirasik. So same story, super gorgeous, super clean circle, doesn't start there. So I really want to hammer that point home as we go forward. I'm going to show you how I would build the support, but again, day one circle is more about how strong you can make it, how well you can make their body connect versus what it's going to look like on a mushroom. And then this is just another video of Rhys. Pretty cool on his Instagram. Just shows his triple Russian flop through the years. But you can see how it grows every single year. His circle gets bigger and bigger and bigger. But he doesn't lose his strength, he doesn't lose his consistency, and that's what we really want. And then now here's this great circle that we all recognize. Right, so that's kind of what I'm talking about. When we're starting with little kids, they don't have the strength and momentum to maintain a big extension. So when you force them to do that, what you get is a lot of leaning. And it looks great, and it starts well, but when you put it up on a pommel horse, on a single pommel, as they get bigger, their shoulders get wider, that leaning is exactly what's gonna pull them off the end. So we'll get into that. The other side of this, and this is controversial, I know. I personally think form on day one is just as important as anything else we're gonna do. So I know we like to start with give the kid a skill, let them make it and clean it up. But what you're doing is, and as we saw before in the Gymnastics Bodies video, we have all these different pieces in your body and kids don't know how to connect that when they're loose. So it's really complicated for them to find the technique if their body is in three or four separate pieces. So what we're seeing here, we're talking about in terms of feedback. So this is just kind of dumb. Stick balancing. She's balancing a stick on her hand. I'm sure everybody's done with a mop or a stick or anything. But that stick is one piece. It doesn't move. So that means 100% of her focus goes straight to her hand. If the stick stays up, she did it right. If the stick falls, she did it wrong. There's no guesswork. Everything we're doing is focused and efficient. Versus this guy down here who's balancing three balls. So now I've got three pieces. He has his support that he's holding. He has the red ball that can cause a fall, and he has the yellow ball that can cause a fall. So now, his 100% of focus is split into three pieces. Same amount of turns, same amount of time. One person is getting 100% focus, the other person is getting 40%. So that's what I'm looking at in terms of form. I want everything we do to be super efficient and super focused on what we need at that level of development. Okay. So, starting from the beginning, I'm going to glaze through it because I think most of us are optional coaches. Again, I don't want to reinvent the wheel, just kind of trying to point out some of the things I look for as I start a circle. I made this video during quarantine for people at home, so I would not do half of this. But I'm going to zoom in on here. These are just basic side steps, trying to make sure that they're sitting tall and they're focusing on the support. Well, again, what I want to zoom in on is from day one, you should be watching their support. So if we're seeing the beginner circle start with a little bit of an elbow bend or a little bit of twitch or a neck sink, when we move forward into our skills on the pommel horse, we're going to see that again. It's going to come back bigger and worse, and we're going to be trying to fix it after years of habits. So wherever you start your circle, however you prefer to do it, make sure that you're watching their support, make sure you're watching it through pushing the pole. All that stuff is going to matter later on. Personally, I do the jump quarter, the jump half, and then I stick a mat in front of him just like this so that we don't get what we saw before, that jump high and finish low. They just circle and stop on that. That's just how I do it. I have to do that. And then after that point, I do the don't fall. So they'll do their half circle, and their goal is to stay on the mushroom, not to fall off. At it, but you can see he tries to pull himself on and then tries to slap around. And this last guy here is a little bit better at it. Does a circle and pulls himself back on. But the important part here is what I don't want to do is tell him, hey, you're leaning the wrong direction. So what we're doing here is providing an environment where he can auto-correct himself. So if I tell him to lean, that's not coming from his support. He's going to move his shoulder. So he's not connected to the mushroom as much as I would want him to. But if he's trying to stay on, he's going to have to fight. He has to figure out how to use his arms. So that's coming from the support. So most of the stuff that you're going to see here is just creating an environment where they can teach themselves and then making sure they're doing it the right way.
So I'm sorry I walked in a little late, but I noticed most of your guys, they have both hands on the palms. Both hands.
Yeah.
Could you talk about, real quickly, the advantage of that versus starting with one hand up in the air?
I think it's just a moving pieces thing, just like we talked about with stick balancing. They can do it, and that's fine, but now they have to focus on their arm too. So just what I'm trying to do is minimize the things they have to think about. That's as simple as I can put it. And then if they get their circles and they've got everything great and they want to go optional and swing their arm out of here, they already have what they want. That's the way I'm looking at it, just trying to narrow their focus. Okay, and then here's one more. It's one of our JD guys, tries hard. Same thing. He's having to auto-correct as he circles around. And everything's coming from that mushroom. So that's what I'm looking for to be in a circle. Okay. Moving forward. We've got our circles. We've got 5, we've got 10, we've got 30. We're in compulsory or almost pommel. How do we maintain that? How do we make it grow so that we can see that same growth that like Reese and Stephen had? Well, the easiest way, at least in my opinion, is to slow them down. Everybody likes a fast circle because it looks nice, but again, the more you lean your shoulders around, the less you're connected to the mushroom. So if you take a step back and make them go slow, you're going to see which kids have it and which kids don't, and it's almost immediate. This guy qualified at level 9 nationals last year, did all right his first year, we weren't expecting much, but as soon as you slow the circle down, you can see guard's good, and then he's done, he can't make it. So basically what you do by taking away the momentum is you amplify all of his problems. He can't hide it, he can't cheat it with the shoulder lean. So as soon as something goes wrong, he can feel it, and he either has to address it, or he's gonna fall. And then again, the purpose of that is to put him in a position where he has to auto-correct his circle. It's becoming normal for him to fix things. You have guys who are great until they're off and they just fall out of nowhere. Things like this will help. It teaches them how to fill those gaps between what feels good and what feels bad. Kind of balance between the two. So with something like this, I would do 5 slow, 5 fast, 5 slow. Always ending on slow. Just to reinforce, and you'll see as soon as he starts, his fast circle is a little wonky. But then when he slows down, he gets back to that strong support again. This guy's a little better at it. You can see how well he's pushing down through his arms. Again, it's not a big circle, but that's going to make the difference when we're talking about flops and rush-ins and all those big skills when they're dead tired at the end of a long set. So that was the basics. want to go back to a point I made earlier, trying to make little kids extend. Extension comes from a momentum. So when you take it away, you're going to end up with your basic shapes, whatever your preferred shape is, whether you want an arch in the front and a hall in the back, or pike in the front and arch in the back. Either way, it's going to boil down to the very basic. Whatever they can do without momentum is what you're going to see. So when we're talking about the reasonable plan hens who start small and finish big, basically what you're seeing is they started in this position, and as they add momentum, it pulls their body straighter and straighter and straighter and straighter until they end up with that extension. So trying to get a little kid whose feet are already down here to do that, you're not going to go the direction you want to go. Especially when we think about the symmetry that we talked about earlier. If your kid's feet are down here and they're trying to circle to the side of the pommel horse, they're going to hit it, right? So what do? They hit, they pop their butt up in the back, and now you've got arch, hollow, and it's hard to control. So this is one of our older guys. I think I drew the lines on here, so you'll see what I'm talking about a little bit. This is a slow circle again. There's no momentum. He has nothing to sustain extension. So what you're seeing is basic shapes. That's it. But as he speeds up, he's going to get a little bit more of that momentum, and you'll see his body just kind of naturally extend out more. So that's what we're talking about. As you add momentum to this strong support, you get the extension that you want to see. Yeah, and I have nothing against it, but personally, I don't drill any circle shapes. So if you're seeing something you like, we didn't do it like that, I promise. It's just the slow, fast circles. It's just some skill work that I'm going to show you later. Yeah, so that's what we got. Okay. So that's how I do it. And they do that maybe 3 or 4 times a week. We do it all the time. Slow, fast, it's a side station. They have to hit it. I hate how the Russians look. They got to go to mushroom, do it slow, just to kind of smooth over whatever's going on. But especially for this group of coaches, I want to hit on skill choice as we get off out of compulsory and off of mushroom. We all want to go for those big skills. Everybody loves a flare Magyar. Everyone loves a Roth or a Lou. But when we're talking about, again, long-term development, none of those skills have a next step. You get a flare Magyar, and then what do you do with it? You have a flare Magyar. That's about it. So what you really need to hit hard, and what I would recommend, is looking at your Moors, your Stockleys, and your Russians. Those three skills make up every skill in every routine ever done. Sorry, it's going to get a little jerky before it slows down. This routine I did with the GoPro on, it was last code, so I'm not sure if it's compliant with the new rules. But first skill we're going to see here, that's a Moor, right? Everyone recognizes that. Take Moor, add a Russian. And you got a Wood. Done. Next skill is a flop. That's just a circle and some Stockleys. Here's a little different, but I do recommend doing half cures. Sorry, I clicked.
Oh.
Yeah, then we got some circles of Russian. Here's one that's pretty big for your new handle guys. I think I rewind backwards so we can see again. Yeah, side travel. If any of you guys struggle with side travels, it's basically a Moor that doesn't turn. So if you're trying to work with those side travels and your kids are having a hard time, it's probably because they're Moor. There's a Moor there. This one's Tom Fay, but just to break it down, you've got a Moor turn and a half Russian. Sorry, this is getting boring. I plan to go through the whole thing. And then this is a rod, that's just more, and again, another Russian. And then here's the big one, flare Magyar Sabato. Look away if you get dizzy. It's a step, and a Stockley A. So every skill that you've got put together is made up of these three skills. Nexus of Auto, same thing, it's a step and a motor. So if you're struggling with any of these big skills, I know you want to get to them as fast as you can, but usually the problem is traced back to more Slavs and Russians. So that's what I meant by earlier. I said I don't really drill certain positions, I don't really drill those things on the sides. What I do is I look at these three skills, and I make these skills as perfect as possible, and then when the kids want to learn something big, go try to play with it. They already have everything they need, they can figure it out. And then this little 1 degree off thing, I don't really know this full saying, but if you're 1 degree off on a rocket to the moon, by the time you get there, you end up like 4,000 miles away out in space. Basically, the idea is if you start with something small and you're a little bit off, by the time you get where you're going, you're completely gone. You're completely off. So that's crazy important when we're talking about these three skills. I'm going to go in depth into them so you can see. But if you're more and your Slavic and your Russian aren't perfect, and by that I don't mean the judges don't take anything, I mean technique. And by the time you get to your travel skills, you're going to have a problem. So more. I like to do the half position first, to make sure they stay tall. Hand placements are always important. And then, this is just a personal preference, I think the form is also important. I use it as a coach. If a kid's doing more and their feet kind of, their knees kind of bend or they kind of twitch, that tells me they don't have the development that I thought they had. So if they're trying to be clean, you can use that as your kind of red flag, like, hey, we need to look at this. If they're not trying to be clean, you're not gonna notice it. This is another tutorial I did. I don't wanna watch the whole thing. Got some physics in it, so if you want that link, I can send it to you. But basically, what I'm looking for here is just right there. And this is not balanced, but I'm looking at the half position. So we're working these skills. We're gonna do maybe one, two circles, and then turn and stop. And that's where we're gonna put most of our focus on. This the most common mistake that you're gonna see. Maybe go to that next. So we talked about that upper and lower body being connected, right? This is your giveaway. This is super exaggerated because it's for Instagram, but but your most common thing that you're gonna see in a circle or a skill or any a flop, anything really, is as they turn, they wanna break. So that's where what you're fixing here. You're trying to make sure that they're connected, and of course that everything is coming from their support. I didn't plan on specifically teaching you how to do more. Is everybody okay with that? So we're just going to run through some, basically what I'm looking for when I'm looking at these skills. This is one of our more talented guys. He killed mushroom level 6, no problem, pretty natural. But what I'm seeing here, if we go back, we can see some of that break. This is what I'm looking at here, what I'm talking about, the positioning. He can be a little better than that, his hands being even. But the dead giveaway is his shoulders being turned in. So if you're seeing that overturn, that tells you right away he's not balanced. So if we take this to a flop, if we take this to a rock, it's gonna fall. And it comes back from this skill right here. So rather than, I think I drew it out, I'm annoyed. If we come back to, or if we get 3 years down the line and then we wanna come back and fix this, like, hey, lean this way, hey, do this, now we've got 3 years of habits to break. So rather than do that, I would suggest hitting these skills as hard as possible. So we can see that in this guy here. You'll see the difference. The circle doesn't look as nice, it's a little choppy, but this is what I want to zoom in on here. So you can see that is a perfectly balanced position. He could probably jump and hold himself there. That means throughout the entire skill, he is completely connected to his post arm. He's not gonna fall. Doesn't matter what skill you put him in, he's gonna be fine. So that's what we're talking about in terms of support. Yeah, there's that right triangle, that red triangle we were talking about. Perfectly balanced. And then last one, same thing. This guy's super strong, so we can cheat it just a little bit. But you can see the same thing. So
what are some drills to correct the guy at the top left corner where he's overturning?
Slow him down. Yeah. If he he's gone, right, if he's slowing down, you can go back to the half, but he competed level 6, he has a skill. If you take him back to the half, he's probably going to be annoyed and not focus as much as he should. So
you actually say, go slow, slow down. Slow
down. So the only reason he's able to move his shoulders like that is because he sped up and he did it. So if we make him go slow, he can't speed up, he's got two choices. Fix it, fall. That's it. So that's kind of what I mean by forcing them to autocorrect. He has no choice but to fix it or fall, so he's going to fix it, slow him down. So we can see those three examples. This guy's a little fast, a little natural, doesn't have the support. This guy's got a pretty good, perfectly balanced, and then our guy on the bottom is kind of in between. So his first one's good, pretty balanced, but his second one, you can see where his habit's going. He turns just a little bit too much. And you can see it because of how his hips break too, right there. So it's small, but yeah, that's his habit, and we'll see it when we move forward. So coaching these three different guys, as you said, on the top, I'm gonna make him slow down. On the bottom, he's just gonna do two sets of three, and I'll let him move on. This guy here, he's trying to make it happen. His habit is more like this guy up here, so this looks a little bit better. So I'll probably just have him do two sets of three and move on. And then again, it seems really dumb I'm focusing on this because these guys are optional, but we'll see what happens when we stick him on handle. So same thing, right there. That's that position that we just drilled forever on bars, right? I'm gonna pause it before it gets there. Yeah. So number one thing on flops, lean, hold, be patient. Like, you hit them all, right, when you're teaching flops, but it comes from this more. So if you drill that, you don't have to teach it. I don't think I've ever told him anything on a flop other than go ahead, have fun, try it. He does it. So, and the secondary part of that, if you can see the second Stockley, he's way off. You can see it from his feet split there. That should be a fall. But because we've drilled that more so heavily and that position so heavily, he knows it. Again, I've never taught him that, but he knows it. So rather than trying to move from this position that he's going to fall in, he waits, and now it's fixed. So, again, Moore's, and we do this all the way up to optional, two sets of three Moore's, either on the palm or the mushroom. Basically, what you're doing, again, is trying to get them to autocorrect these things. So, yeah, I could tell him, hey, you got too much space, keep your hands closer, push down, and do this. But when he hops up on the pommel and he's off in a different direction, he's kind of stuck, he doesn't know what to do. So that goes back to what we were talking about in the basic circle and being able to auto-correct and knowing those checkpoint positions and holding that support super strong. Stockley works the same way. Stockley is your flop skills, some of your simple handstand skills, your Magyars, so super important. Basically the same thing, we're looking for that strong position on the side there. Pretty balanced. His habit, because he is so strong, is kind of lean back a little bit. And of course, the same thing, we want him to autocorrect, and we can see how that plays out on the pommel horse when he goes up there. First one's fine. Second one, he's leaning back a little bit more. And we're going to see the result of that on his hips as he pikes out of it. And the third one's pretty much, it's worse. He leans back more.
Now, is that an issue of fatigue? Is he doing the repetition? He gets tired, and so he's leaning back more? Or is it just...
You could think about it that way. I think...
It's habitual?
His habit is to lean back.
Yeah.
So the first one, when he's focused super hard, is going to be nice.
Okay.
But that's not his habit. That's him thinking about it super hard. So if you have a kid who does great routines in the gym when they're fresh and they feel good, and they get to a meet and completely fall apart, it's because, just like this kid, in the meet when there's a little pressure, you see the habits come back. So that's what we're trying to change here. And again, same thing, I would just make him slow his circle down and do two sets of three Stockleys just to fix it. Okay, Russian, it's one of those kind of gimmicky bonuses. It's not hard for a strong kid to do. They can hop around and make it happen. But this is one of the most important skills to actually go slow and hammer out. I can say that from my own experience. I did the triple Russian on floor, super hoppy, but I got my C and I was happy, and then I spent the rest of my college career sucking at Russians. So those habits you develop early on in Russian are really important. Don't just go for the easy bonus, don't just go for the easy tens, take your time. And then this is a good example why. I'm gonna play through first, and I'll talk about it. So we're gonna Roth, right off the side, right? Pretty common. But as we learned before, Roth is just basic skills put together. So if we zoom in on what he's doing, we can see before he starts, before he even starts the skill, he's already anticipating that turn. And so we can see that same shoulder positioning we saw on the mushroom and the moor. So already he's off on a bad start before he goes anywhere. And then of course, he's not balanced here, so his next step will also not be balanced. And then we can see that as his shoulder swing around the side. So especially for optionals, as you're looking at these bigger skills, you don't have to spend all that time on a Russian, but you'll spend 3 or 4 or 5 as much time on the Roth and the Lube trying to fix that same thing you could have fixed before. So again, if you want to focus on the sport, you gotta go slow. So this is the way I started. This guy on the top left, he is day one, never done it before. I thought it was a good look at how it looks. He just kind of leans on it and walks away around. And then again, I know earlier I harped on form and made a big deal out of it, but for this skill specifically, we're talking about connecting their pieces. So when they're tight and their habits are already to pipe like this, they're not going to make that connection that we want to see in the Russian. So if you straddle them out, now he's forced to kind of lean on it, and now his whole body is that one piece versus having this space in what we're doing. So that's what you're seeing. He's just doing a straddle and walking around. Again, no momentum, so he can't throw his shoulders to cheat anything. There's no cheating going on here. He has to be pushing down. He has to move himself with his arms. And I think I'm just showing, that every step he takes is even and controlled. The most common thing to see in a Russian is as they take that step, they kind of overstep that shoulder. So you get more of this rhythm instead of nice and even. And this is an easy way to get rid of that and not ever have to deal with it. This guy's a little more advanced, so you're gonna see he is more balanced, he is more pressed onto his hands. That's the control that we're seeing. And he's just walking and sliding. Yeah, that's it. It's super simple. Little kids love it because they can slide around, it's not hard. But as we said before, you can't have extension without momentum. So from this slow circle, they have to slide. And until they figure out how to do it well, they're going to slide and it's not going to look well. I threw myself on the end, not because I had to, but I was just kind of being lazy in the moment. I do these every day. So you can see I'm working with a little more momentum than they are. So now I have enough space to get my legs off. Key here is that every step is pretty even and everything is nice and smooth. There's no place that anything is out of control. And the next step would be to add a circle. Again, as soon as you have momentum, they don't need the support. They're most likely not going to use it. So we're going to see an example of that. This guy here, the same guy as we saw before in the middle. He does his circle. And right there, we can see he's already got that same turn from the moor that we don't want to see. So, of course, his Russian is choppy and hopped. So, zooming in on his shoulders again. Stuff gets boring and kind of repetitive, but as we talked about in our symmetry before, we're seeing something there, a little bit off there, we're gonna see him hit right here and get stuck on that side. So that's the same problem we saw in the Roth before. Kind of cut his shoulders, and then of course he's gonna fall from the other side. So what should it look like? super smooth, that kid doesn't fall in a Russian. So that's what we're trying to develop. If you have that, you can take it anywhere. You can put it on a handle, you can put it in the middle of a pommel, you can walk with it. It's not a big deal. So here we're seeing that same balance, even shoulders that we saw more. And then every step you see the same thing. And all of these guys develop that from that slow Russian. That's my go-to. I like it. I make our little compulsory guys do it. If they want to make that bonus, you gotta show me this well, or what's the point, right? Okay. So optionals, that was the basic stuff, and the most important thing I wanted to hit. Again, if your kids have done Morris for 3 years, it's probably still not good enough. If you want to take them as far as you can take them, I do Morris every day, and I'm competing elite. I do Stockley's every day, I'm competing elite, and I do basic Russian. So again, we talked about being just a little bit off and the effect that can have in the long run. You really want those skills to be perfect. But once you have it, you can kind of let your kids play. So this is just a fun video. I know we like our woos and our rots. It's not hard. It's just your basic Russian. And then a step. That's it. So if you've developed this connection and support that you have in your Russian, you can do whatever you want with it. You can take it up, you can take it down, you can put it on a handle, it doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
So this is how I can do it. And this is that same kid we saw fall on his Roth. So of course this is kind of help him smooth it over. Do the same thing we did on the mushroom, super slow so he can't cheat any step, and then he just walks with it. And he's forced to find that balance, he's forced to stay supported. It's just that simple. I think I played with it. Yeah. You can do the same thing with the handles. Sorry, my form wasn't good. I'm trying. But you can see the difference in a well-controlled Russian and one that's kind of just natural and hobby. So when you're watching upper-level optional guys, especially when you're talking about teaching those Russians and Roths and Lus, you'll see a lot of that hoppy throw, shoulder throw. That's great if you get it in a meet. They're fighting to stay on, that's fantastic. But if you have that as your normal basic and then something happens, they're gone. So you want to make your normal, I guess we like to say your zero position, you want to make their basic as close to perfect as possible. And then if they deviate a little bit as they get under pressure or something happens, you won't have a problem in the long run. But if you're seeing that that space that you usually see in those woos every single day, and they're probably starting at, instead of starting at zero, they're probably starting at like plus five. So if they go any more than that, they fall. If that makes sense. Yeah, so I think that's most of it. Yeah, major takeaways from here. Long-term goals, again, I know we're chasing those skills, but really, you can get anything you want if you focus on the support. My own career, the reason I walked through it like that, I didn't have a lot of that kind of extension and drilling in, so I had a very natural support. But what I didn't have was all of those more stocky and Russian checkpoints. So the first year, maybe not year, maybe first couple, 2 or 3 months of my career at OU, I did mushroom for like an hour a day and just filled those gaps. And that was the difference between what you saw 46 and 17th in the country, was literally just hopping on a mushroom and filling those gaps that I had before. So again, your focus should be spent on that support so that when they get older, they can do whatever they want. And I'm also a testament to that. 2014, I went through the code and checked off every single skill from start to finish. It took me like 2 weeks to get it all done. And it really was just because I'd spent 2 or 3 years getting that support, so it wasn't anything different. It's just a more in a different place or a rush in a different place and put it together and we're done. And then another highlight on form. Again, I think it's super important. It's easy for them to feel what they need. We're talking about feedback. And then the big one, again, especially for pommel horse, you want them to auto-correct. Yes, it's rewarding as a coach to be able to tell your kid one correction, they fix it, and they hit their routine. But what if they need a correction in a different spot? You're telling them to go left, go left, go left, and now they're too far left. Eventually, you have to tell them to go right. So especially when you're talking about elites, developing long term, it's more important that they know the middle and they can figure out how to find it versus constantly being pushed in one direction or the other and going back and forth.
So, Michael,
Yes.
From a practical application of what you just said, which I agree with 100%. What do you encourage your athlete? How do you, how is better?
I can give you a perfect example.
How do you encourage your athlete when he does a skill? What is your reaction when he comes off the horse? What
first,
do you say to him?
First, I don't say anything the first time.
Okay.
So I try to make sure that all my kids know what to do. And of course, if you know it and you're trying it, you're going to make mistakes sometimes. So I don't want to jump on them. I'll watch it 2, 3, or 4 times to make sure, like, oh, they're actually in the right direction, the wrong direction. They actually need to be directed. And then I'll say something. So, great example, the kid we saw doing the Russian dismount earlier. He's working Magyars. He should have it, should be easy. But he was struggling to actually step up on the handle. So he would either step up and be too far back, or he'd step up and be too far forward. And that's frustrating for him because he doesn't have those problems on pommel. So he comes to me asking a question, and my only response was, fix your skew before you step up. That's not gonna fix his Magyar. It won't. But what I'm seeing is because he's skewed in his loop, when he steps up, his shoulders are sideways. He can't find his balance. So no matter what he tries at this point, he's going to struggle. So the autocorrect would be fix your skew. Now, if he steps up and he's too far forward, he can feel it. If he's too far backwards, he can feel it. So the correction I give him is just a way for him to figure it out, not the actual answer.
So do you ask him?
Yeah, and I'll make sure he's in the right place. I'll kind of talk him through it. And then after the practice, he asked, like, why couldn't you just tell me that? And I told him, well, what's going to happen when you do Servato? You're going backwards and you have the same problem. So the fix for him to fix his skew was he needed to pull more with his left hand. That's how he scores himself up. But when you get to the other side of the pommel and he's doing Servato now, if you pull with your left hand, you're going forward. So how does he fix that skew going backwards? It's a completely different hand, right? You push with his right hand to go backwards. So again, that's kind of what I meant by too far left, too far right. If I told him pull here, now I also need to tell him push here. He can't figure it out himself. I've kind of cheated him of that learning opportunity. So by focusing in on just the basic, which would be an even circle with no skew, he's forced to figure out how to fix that skew himself. Yes?
When you say day one form, I'm assuming you're talking form means, in this case, the right technique that you expect to see. We talk about the perfect quarter turn on the check care.
No, not necessarily. I mean straight legs, pointed toes, feet together.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
The technique stuff, they're going to trial and error. It takes time to figure out. But again, we go back to the biomechanics slide. If they're tight, everything's going to be more focused in the direction we want. If they're loose, maybe they get
they fall.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, questions. I'm done. That's all I had. I've got the
And questions. If I jump one more time, you know, okay, thank you for that. And the other was personal thoughts, if you are okay, on future starts. Little kids, you know, sometimes they say future starts is a way to get into the right track, right? And they want to see that perfect extension on it side to side. Do you encourage your kids to do that, or you prefer, hey, we need to support first? How do you go about this discrepancy?
It depends. I think gymnastics has three different angles to look at it. You got your physics and your technique that they need to make a skill. You've got the feeling. One kid may feel it this way, one kid may feel it this way. It's different, it's individual. And then the third one is, of course, what the judges are looking for. So as a coach, you do have to balance all three of those things. We personally don't do future stars. We try to aim for peaking at their first year level 10. So everything we're doing is geared towards that. But if future stars is super important for you, you do have to consider what the judges are looking for. So I would say do a lot of slow, fast circles as much as you can, because you're going to have to develop your support twice.
Program note, future stars is about to change drastically. Can't give you all the specifics yet, but it's run its course. And we're about to make a big change, both in terms of how it's done, at what time in the year, and what the content is to ask for it. Personal question. Max Whitlock.
Strongest support in the game.
Strongest support in the game.
Yeah.
Not the most extended circle in the world.
Nope.
Even tempo all the way.
Yeah, he doesn't doesn't fall.
He doesn't fall.
So if you're looking for kind of like a program view of it, because if we pick one athlete, you can find a good athlete, you can find a bad. But if you're looking for like a program-wide view of it, I think the Russians do a good job. It doesn't matter what their guy looks like, if he's a beefy ring guy or a lanky pommel guy, they can swing pommel. And they make finals when they don't look like they should make pommel finals, but it's because they all kind of use the same circle technique. They're not trying to push extension, they're just trying to be strong and consistent. And across the board, you can see that throughout their program.
What are you doing, like, conditioning-wise to maintain that support?
My view on it is just be consistent. I know a lot of people have wrist problems, especially with kids and when we're ramping up to routines. So we don't do a lot of that. They do 30 circles every day. Our older optionals, that's like a basic strength. Our younger ones might do, like our pommelless guys, I had them doing 20-20-10-10, which is 20 front loops, 20 back loops, and then 10 on each side, just so they get a feel for each part of the course. But I think it's really more about doing it every day. If you miss a day, that's gonna affect them long term. If you push super hard on a couple days and then you back off, that's gonna affect them long term. So I try to find like the middle ground and then just ride it as long as possible. Yeah, anything you got?
Does any of this focusing more on the support help with any wrist pain that we always see with all these things?
Yeah, for sure. If you got a big lean, that's more pressure on your hands. I tell my kids in flops that all the time, especially elbow pain, forearm pain. If you're off, if you're not balanced, you have to fight to get back on. Mm-hmm. And that puts a lot of pressure on all those joints. So if you are pushing straight down, you have a better support, things line up a little more naturally, you have a little bit of less pain.
Do you find that kids stop putting their hands this far on a mushroom or this close on a mushroom whenever you're focusing just on the support?
I actually never had to say that. I think if you slow them down, they figure out what's best for them.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah. Very interesting.
What's up?
All right. Can you give me an idea of, like, let's say you've got a pommel, you run a pommel for a second. What is that structure of that workout look like? Are you having to do a couple reps first and then certain numbers?
What level are you talking?
In general.
General.
Both of them.
Probably do their 30 circles, competition warm up, one or two routines, and then skill time. Whatever they want to work. And by whatever they want to work, it means whatever they know that they need that I've told them they need.
There you go. There you go.
Not a free throw.
Yeah, not a free throw.
A 30 circle based warm up built on top of the circle.
Right. Yeah, and then the extra stuff I was talking about, I call it like their everyday stuff or their side stations. So while they're doing whatever skill they want to focus on, in between their turns, they're hitting their slow fast or their mores or their scissors or whatever else we're focusing on.
So the 30 is not part of your slow fast sequence. It's just get up and out.
That's basic. That's like we finish our warm up. Okay, basic strength, go. They knock out the 30 circles and then we move on.
So if you have a kid that can't make 30, it's a support issue generally.
Yeah, maybe. Or timing, development. But depending on the day, some days is about 30 where you need it, and some days is about endurance. So if that kid can't make it, then he needs to go to the mushroom and knock out his 30 in a row for endurance. Anything?
Do you guys do much like wrist strength at all in your program?
No. No, don't do any, actually. I do, personally. I think any wrist pain you get is from changing things. So if they took a lot of time off and now we're doing something, it's going to hurt. If we ramped up what we're doing, it's going to hurt. If they're doing a little bit out of their comfort zone for too long, it's going to hurt. So it's more about finding that middle ground. What can we do every day without causing any pain? And then over time, gradually increasing that.
What about forearm pain? Any issues with that?
Yeah, it happens.
Conditioning,
not so much. It depends. Little kids, if they have any pain like that, you're done. Go to Trent, work air sense. But older guys, again, you just moderate what they're doing. It means they're doing too much of something or something's wrong. Again, if they're really off and they're having a fight, they're going to get that extra stuff. So.
And then, Mike, if I can, by the way, this is great. I hope you understand, this takes patience. It's about a long-term view about where they will be with. You heard him say, future stars. Now, I'm a big program guy, but it's about long-term view. Their long-term view is, what can we do to get them ready when they're level 10s? My dear friend, Vladimir Artemov, always used to say when I'd go to his gym, wow, what a specimen you've got there with that 9-year-old. His comment is, yeah, we'll see when he's 16.
Yeah.
You know? Don't make decisions too early. Don't push too early. Build foundations. And be patient with these kids. Be patient and let them develop. Wrist pain, I think the comment you made is critical. If you don't have a solid basic support with a right triangle, you are taxing the muscles of the front arm and the lateral collateral ligament and cartilage in the wrist. You're taxing it. That's the key. Because everything is about hands. Everything's about support.
As a reference, when 29 is here, I still follow, so.
Way to go!
Yeah.
You survived.
My plan, I'm older, so I'm not trying to learn any skills, just maintaining, clean things up. So Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday are routines for me. I do 2 routines each one of those days. Wednesday's off, Saturday's off, just because, again, I have everything I need. But I do that. I'm 29, and I'm still doing that. That's 8 routines a week. They're not small routines. I think first one's 6-2, second one's 6-6. So, like, they're big sets, but because I've been consistent, I know when to push, when to back off. I don't really need to do much. I think I do like 5 minutes of prehab, that's about it. And I don't use wrist support anymore.
Good man.
Nice.
Yeah, hope you got something out of that. So those videos I skipped through, if you want the links for them, they do have a lot of information in it. I just didn't think I had enough time to play it all. So hit me up for that if you want. Otherwise, thanks for coming.